What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Thumb Throttle Podcast. Mm-hmm. I'm your host, John Yankovich. Here's my sidekick, number 34, Colton.
The co-host.
Mm-hmm. So, it's been a little bit since we've done the last one. We've been busy. And what have we been busy with?
Working on quads. Tearing stuff down. Yeah. Putting stuff back together.
Yep. We've tore apart the national bike. Sent it everything out. And we're slowly getting parts back. We got the frame back from Bobby at TSR, and we did the Honda Red, because ride red, right?
Yeah,
that's right. And what a phenomenal job Bobby did. I asked him to put a little bit of blue and pearl flake in it to go with our red, white, and blue, and wow, it turned out amazing. So we get that together. Got everything back up as a roller. We're waiting for our custom axis new shocks.
The front ones.
Yes, we went with once again one of our sponsors, Custom Axis. We went with long travel. We did short travel last year, so we have a set of regular travel.
Or no, we did standard travel last year.
Yeah, standard travel last year. So we have a set of standard travel front shocks up for sale.
What are they, 16 inches?
I got to look at them. I think they're 13 something. But if anyone's interested in them, we just get a hold of me and we'll make you a deal on those, cheaper than new.
Because they're used.
Well, yeah, but they're basically brand new. We only ran half a season on them. So getting rid of those. Waiting for the motor to come back from Shoop. He's covered up with all his national stuff right now. And since we're not going to run the first couple GNCCs, I told him we can wait a little bit. So other than that, just been busy putting bikes together, working on a practice bike, and waiting for the rain to stop so we can get out there and get back riding again. Holding to our resolutions of getting back in shape, we've also started working out, so that's good, and we're sticking with it. This week, I'll be on afternoon, so you'll be on yourself to hold yourself accountable, as will I. Anything else new?
No, not really.
No. So, as our second podcast, we went and got a guest. We did an interview with the founder of New East Coast, Ronnie Paul Wilson, and we had him on there and talked about the New East Coast and, you know, how it started, a couple other things that are going on, just how he's done the series for so long and how he's been into it. And, you know, we'll put him on the interview. We'll put this on here. One thing we also touched on was the factory ride ticket that they had.
Yeah.
And he went into detail about that. What a great ticket. It's like a gun bash ticket for quad riders and or bike riders in general. And whatever, if you win the ticket, you win everything. It's just not one thing. Mm-hmm. It's everything. And there's a lot of stuff on there. And like he was talking about, it's kind of like a precursor to what they want to do going forward. And he talks about all that stuff. So get Ronnie on the phone and we'll talk to him.
So on the phone, we got Ronnie Paul Wilson from the New East Coast. How's it going, Ronnie?
Good. Good. Real good.
Good. Awesome. How's the winter treating you? Hoping not too bad.
Just trying to stay in grandpa shape. We got a new grandbaby here as of a couple of days ago, and trying to get him broke in here, getting ready, start stapling arrows and running those and stuff. You know.
Yeah, I saw that. Congratulations.
Thanks.
So we'll just get into this. So we started racing about 2 years ago. I think 2 years ago we ran our first New East Coast, and that was towards the end of the year. I want to say at out in Greensboro, I believe. Mm-hmm. So, and we loved it. We were running another series before that, and I really liked the New East Coast. So how did the whole New East Coast thing start? How did you come up with that?
This is 11 years of it. We've actually, the whole concept of doing a race series has been about 15, 16 years ago. My kids was way younger then, but I had a factory Polaris deal that we were sponsored by Flares, had a race team. My cousin Mike Soroka and some friends, Spud Howe and them. You know, we've raced. It seems like we've raced forever. When I say race forever, I mean I literally have almost 40 years involved in it. You know,
wow.
A lot of quads and bikes. You know, since then, but we always on the you know the virtual road trip, as I say. Because it seems like it's never ending and you just do it relentless, you know, traveling all the GNCC, setting in construction and traffic jams, you know, construction zones. And it's like, we're going to just do our own race series, you know what I mean? And not do all this, but we still do it all. And then the opportunity came along to basically it was to take over one, which that kind of got, you know, sideways on a few notes, but we was able to overcome that and just get it to where we wanted it without everybody else's issues. That's where it started it, and we changed it to our liking, put it that way.
Yeah. I know from the time we started, it was a very tight knit and very close racing community that you have racing for you. And that's one thing that I really liked. You know, some of the other series we raced, and I don't put down anybody.
Right.
You know, that's really not what it's for. But I bet
more
people within just the four or five races that we've raced New East Coast than we've met anywhere else. And it was, I think that's one of the biggest things. And I hear that a lot. From you know the other people that run the New East Coast is just how good of a series it's run, how nice the people are, and I've never heard a bad thing about them yet. So I mean you're doing something good.
Well, we try, and one thing with us, so I mean it's my wife and my two kids. Basically, it was just me and my wife for a couple of years. Obviously, kids younger and school and stuff, and. Anything, but my kids grew up racing every weekend. I mean, I remember we was in a District 5 race at Brownsville, and my daughter's, you know, she was 6 weeks old, maybe. And we're riding around the pits, you know what I mean? Just there, I would ride around the quad to put her asleep. I mean, isn't that the way you do it?
You know, yeah,
all kids grew up on quad, right?
Yeah, like Colton, I'd take him, we'd go shed hunting, and I'd have the grizzly out, and I'm telling you what, within 1,000 yards from the house, he was out, and I spent more time trying to keep him on the bike than I did riding around looking for sheds.
Right. Well, I mean, even right now, my granddaughter, you know what I mean, even at the races now, it's like, you know, the girls be on the radio, it's like, hey, come get this, take her for a ride, you know what I mean, because it's like, Pat puts her on a quad, and I mean, we go for a little bit, and I think that, you know, I think she's going to sleep, got her head on my shoulder or whatever, and here she's just waving at everybody going by,
yeah.
You know. Well, my biggest thing of it is, but that's where I like to do it because it's like, obviously, it's our business, but it's our family reunion every weekend, whether it's a GNCC or the New East Coast or whatever, where we're at. Our race family is our family. I mean, literally, half of it's blood and the rest of it we claim. I don't know why all the time, but we do. You know,
see,
as far
you actually do new or GNCC too as well, right? You help with the GNCC.
Yeah, they've helped the Coombs family and everybody there, Russell, you know, Jeff Russell and all them guys, and everybody there has always been helpful. And if we've ever needed anything, I've made a phone call, whether it was information or, you know, it's information, whatever, doing, you know, I've been around those people for, oh my, every bit of getting close to 50 years, because I was a kid working in High Point, you know.
Wow.
And it's been a while. It's definitely been a minute.
It's just crazy that, like, we've just started this 2 years ago, and I wish we'd have started it a lot sooner, but hey, better late to the party than never. But I just, so many people that we've run into have been doing this for so long that it just blows my mind.
Yeah, and it's, well, one thing about this sport, like, you got guys, I mean, don't get me wrong, I know everybody, I know tons of families that's been in and out of it for, you know, 25, 30 years. I mean, the kids, we'll put it this way, pro riders, like, I don't know if you know who Brian Henderson is, the Henderson Boys Racing, Henderson Brothers Racing. Okay, well, I met Brian, like, in 92, 93. Well, it was 93 at Blackwater. I mean, his mom, his dad, his wife now, but his girlfriend then. I met them guys there, and we didn't see him for 20 years, and here they show up at, you know, at our series one day, and it's like, hey, man, it's been a while. And it's like, well, hell, here they all are. Here's you, your two kids, your wife, your two kids. It's like, he said, you just, and it's all of us say it, once you start this, you just don't walk away from it.
Yeah.
It's put it this way, just to walk away from it and never look back is a special breed of people to do that, because everything that we do, it's all, even on the worst day of the worst rain and storms and everything, my duck butt, it's still fun, you know.
Yeah.
So even one person may not have fun, it might feel miserable because you're soaking wet for, you know, 28 hours. It's like, yeah, it happens, but it's a part of life that we've learned to love. So it's the sport that we get addicted to, and you, like I say, just can't walk away. But to know, for knowing these people, like the Hendersons, and I mean the Holberts and everybody involved, I mean, I'm talking like the Holbert family has been, you know, Mike especially, and Steve, his cousin, all the guys and that we was around with and helped years ago racing. Like Steve used to ride for me, Holbert, you know, his pro ride, rode a Cannondale and a Polaris for me.
Wow.
And these guys was around it forever, but this sport to them, it's just second nature. I mean, you wake up in the morning, you either go to work or go to a race. So that's why we took our race into work. So that's where we go.
Yeah, that's the old saying. If you find something you love to do, you never work a day in your life.
Yeah, and don't get me wrong, and being that I get to do it with my family, you know, every day. There's days that you think one chokes each other out and stuff like that, argue, but at the end of the day, that's life. You know what I mean? It's family. So, and even and all the help, and I'm going to say there's on race day the average amount of people we have there literally sign up, course marshaling, whatever. I think we're 23 people, 26 people.
Yeah. Wow.
And they're either friends of the family lifetime, or, you know, just family now, you know?
Right, right. So,
and
speaking of family, I ran into somebody at the Mountaineer, and we got to talking and found out that he was related to you. So who actually does the tracks? Is it you or is it Seth?
Seth.
Seth? Because he laid claim to it. Because I said something about, you know, how you make your tracks, and I like them. He said, what are you talking about? I make all the tracks.
Right. No, that's, yeah. Hey, when he come in, you know, he come in, and it's like, I want to do this. And I mean, we butt heads, you know, every now and then on stuff. It's just old school way of thinking, and the new stuff. And like, listen, he talks to, you know, all these guys, and they like his stuff because he's also a racer, you know what I mean? And the old school hard knock stuff of, you know, the old Blackwater tracks, you know, the old gnarly stuff.
Yeah.
It's just making it passable where they're putting the new faster stuff in with the new modern stuff versus what we had. Even the old 250R back then, don't get me wrong, I love my 250Rs, but some of this new stuff, suspension-wise, and we didn't have tire balls back then just to go blasting through rocks and not worrying about, anything you worry about now is just breaking the bike in half. Before,
right.
It was worried about flat. You know, and
right.
You had to slow it down. Now it's just, who can hold on to it through the gnarliest stuff wide open, and that's what it seems like it is.
And see, it's just, it's crazy, and there's like this lag here in the phone, so I don't mean to be cutting you off. It's like,
no, you're fine.
So I don't know the old school stuff because, like I said, we just started 2 years ago. Like up until this, my competitive background was in high school was baseball and wrestling, and then I started bass fishing, and I did that for, oh man, looking back on it, almost 15, 20 years. And then when I had kids, and you know, people once told me, they're like, you know, your sports and your interests will evolve into what your kids are interested in. And you know,
right.
Colton never got interested in fishing, and I never thought he was even interested in bikes because I bought him a quad, and that thing sat in the garage for almost 2 years before he started riding it, and then he started riding it and couldn't get off it. So,
ripping on it.
Yeah. But right. All the stuff that, like, Seth does, like, now the new school, like, that's all I know. Like, I didn't know what it was like old school, and from hear you talking about it, it seems – I kind of like the old school, just making it passable and go, because I mean, I'm old, and I mean, I'm not old. I'm 44, but when I get on a bike, I feel like I'm 84.
Right?
I would appreciate the speeds getting slowed down a little bit.
Well, that's one thing about Seth on the track. So he has ridden a bunch of it, but like, when we first started the race series, it was, as me and my one buddy, you know what I mean? It's like, his name's Alan, but we've told him, like, he gets mad. You call him by his name, we call him Spud. But he would, like, literally, he raced back in the day. And I mean, we all rode, like, Barry Hawk on quads, you know what I mean? And we're back from that older era of quad riders. Mm-hmm. So it's like, it was not to have everything. You don't want it stupid crazy to where it's a chance of someone getting hurt all the time just to try to do a hill climb. You have to make
right.
it passable, you know,
right.
And actually, well, then Barry worked for GNCC, and like Barry even referenced, you know, Jeff Russell always told him, just remember KISS, keep it simple, stupid. Well, you look mm-hmm. at it like, oh, you want to make this hard and rough and, you know, grueling. It's like, but not, it's not for everyone for an hour and a half at a time. To 2 hours,
right?
You know what I mean? You have to
right.
make it to where that kid learning, we grew up on motorcycles and ATVs, to where kids today have not. They've just been on for a short time. I mean, there's a few. I mean, Seth has ridden with all these guys since he could walk. I think he was on a quad before he could walk. He raced his first race at 3 years old. You know, so
wow.
It's like, he's been on them and do there, but he's just, it's something that he loves and it's just second nature to him. We don't think nothing about it. I worried more about my guys on the race team out on a racetrack more than him, because it's like he knows better. You know what I mean? He
right.
just knows. I just trusted him more. But it was like, I mean, I've always worried, safety wise of going to a national event or whatever, just not knowing the track, like we didn't lay out, but he was always more laid, more conservative rider, like through the rough stuff. He didn't really tear a lot of stuff up until he got on the second 90. Then he broke that stupid thing every other race, just
that's,
crushing them. You know what I mean? Then the 125s, it escalated from there.
that's where we're at. That's where I'm at now is the 125, and it's every race he comes back and nothing major. I am. Knock on wood, a lot of the major stuff, because you know we've been putting the good stuff on it, but it's just nickel and dime stuff, and my wife is like, well, we just bought this or we just bought that, and I'm like, this isn't made to stand up to this kind of abuse. I'm like, it is going to break, and it does. Like, he is so hard on these bikes, it's crazy.
Well, I can tell you one thing about the only thing that kind of sucks right now is you cannot buy them brand new,
right?
And that's the big problem, because everything gets fatigued and everything. But where we lucked out with Seth on the 125, when they first hit the market, even before they even got them close, I mean, I deal with all the bike shops around, because we work on motorcycles and ATVs also all the time, for you know, other than racing. Was in Miller's Yamaha in Uniontown, PA, there, when they got the first one in, I said, just put it in my truck. You know, I'm taking it. For Seth to get on a brand new bike and was I mean, he run that thing, I think, two races, and I think it was running one of Paul Koontz's races there in West Virginia, and he bent a, I think he bent a brake rotor on it because it had that little plastic skid plate. But we couldn't buy a part, which is, yes, it's the same rotors like the Raptor 250, but the parts was back, we couldn't get it. So it's like, well, listen, we have a race next weekend too, so what do? We went back to the dealership and bought another bike. But at that point, when they was just new out and there were a bunch of them, it's like, oh, whip out the old Yamaha credit card, because here we come.
Right.
And, but
like now you can't do that, because not only they don't make bikes anymore, so it's not like you can just go out and do that. It's like, and with the supply issues now, it's even harder.
Right. And well, that's where I was getting at, you know, as far as doing that. But one thing that was nice about having the new bikes, because literally the one I bought brand new because the other one was broke. And it's like, okay, well, we took the brand new. I left it in a truck. I went in and got it on Saturday. And we went to the next race on Sunday out there. I literally cut the tags off of it in the bed of the truck. And, you know, you pull it out and I said, here, boy, break it in. I mean, it'll literally hold it wide open for an hour. So,
yeah.
And all the ones that we have built, like he finished, his national number was number two on the first full year of the GNCCs on them, you know, on the 125. And
yeah.
God's honest truth, that thing, I put chains and sprockets on it, I think twice throughout the year because we had special gearing made for it. He was a big kid. I mean, he was 150 pounds riding that thing. But as far as maintenance-wise and stuff, it's like, it was nice to maintain a new bike. But when you got to start, you know, get third, you know, second year in on, I'm like, man, I wish we'd had another new one.
Yeah, and it's not, you don't have that luxury anymore. I mean, even the frames now, you can't even, it's hard to get the OEM frames. And if you went with like a Lone Star, I mean, you're waiting 5-6 weeks at least for a frame.
Yeah, that and the Lone Star frames are way heavier, though, too.
Yeah, they are. But it's one of those. But, yeah, Ronnie, we're closing in. Oh, 22 minutes now. One thing I wanted to talk, I'm sure that we covered the factory ride ticket that you're doing this year. I know I got a couple of them, even though that I'm probably just making a donation. I've only ever won one of anything in my life. So consider my ticket a donation, but I was looking at that, and man, you got together a lot of stuff for that ticket. I mean, whoever wins that thing is going to be set for a while.
Yeah, and speaking of the ticket there, and this is just a precursor of what's yet to come. All the sponsors and people have donated to this ticket. I mean, they are behind the series, my series. They're behind racing, period. They're behind the sport. I mean, Kenda, Wasner Piston, all the bike shops that's involved. I don't have tickets in front of me at the second. Just to read them all off. I am getting a little C now. I am old, you know, 50 now, so. But it catches up. But it's just what we're wanting to do with this is obviously we take the proceeds from this, and it's why our kids that qualify get a free dinner, but they don't have to pay for the banquet ticket, you know, stuff like that. So obviously my goal is what we'd like to do. We're, you know, we're covering it again for this year. Next year, I'd like to start another deal to do another ticket of the same style but do it say like midsummer or so. But I'm actually wanting to do a ticket of the same style with, like, I mean, as long as everybody goes for it again, which I think they will, because they all really like the idea of it, but actually take all that same stuff on a ticket, but then add a new ATV or motorcycle choice to it.
Wow. Yeah, that'd be nice.
So obviously you can't go buy new 125s or 250 quads. I won't do a monetary value of the bike, because we want to make sure someone's getting a bike to ride or race, whatever. It's you take your pick of the quad or that, but we can ultimately, like, we can turn it into, we're going to price it out as a YFZ 450 quad, or price a YZ450 dirt bike. So you want to buy your ticket, you know, considering your kid. Well, he's not big enough for a YZ450 dirt bike or 450 quad. But if you want to say you want a dirt bike, we can actually downscale that, use that same monetary value of that bike and get, say, an 85 dirt bike or a 125 dirt bike, whatever. You know what I mean?
Right.
But
right.
The idea of it is to get people riding. You don't have to race. It's just riding. So
that's one thing that I was, when you did your Facebook post on how the ticket was, it didn't matter if whatever you won on there, like if you were a bike racer and you won, I'm just off the top of my head, set of Kenda tires,
yeah,
for an AP. Like you basically said, like, look, whatever you win, if you can't use it, we will make it right, because this ticket
the ticket is based by of what you ride and what your preference is. You can be a side-by-side guy. You can be the farmer riding around the field. And if you want to run, you know, race gas through your side-by-side, or you need tires for your farm buggy, we'll get you covered. Or if you need, you know, a top end, the idea of it, it's the matter. The only thing I didn't include into this ticket was our lawnmower races, because until Briggs & Stratton comes off something, I'm not promoting their engine stuff.
There's guys on the lawnmowers. They're a special breed. I don't want to tempt myself with that, because I got a hard enough time just figuring out the quads right now, let alone trying to race a race mower. So,
hey, but I mean, have you seen like the first one we had at Greensboro over there, when those couple of guys showed up from Ohio with the, I think it was like an old wheel horse or something, and had that Honda motor on it. Those mm-hmm. guys are coming out of the corners, wheeling out of the corners. And I mean, that thing sounds like a dragster coming up to you. I was like, oh man, check this out.
Yeah.
It was nuts.
I'm just following the YouTube rabbit hole down one day, and I seen a guy basically taking, it was an old Gravely or wheel horse, one of the two. He cut, I don't even know if you can consider it a tractor, because he scrapped 90% of it, and I think he put an R1 engine in it. And I'm like,
I saw that video.
I'm like, man, this guy has a death wish.
Right? Yeah. See, our rules don't allow that. You still have to be. It has to be a mower based chassis and not a zero turn or nothing. It has to be a mower based chassis and a mower based engine.
Yeah.
So you can't use street bike stuff. Now in Ohio, they flat track those things, oval track and stuff. And I mean, they are crazy. Some of those things, 100 mile an hour plus. It's like, there's no way.
Yeah, it's
no way you ever get on one.
If you, it's crazy what, if you give people enough time, what they'll put a motor in and what they'll eventually start racing.
Yeah. Right?
But
it's like, but back to that ticket real quick, though, just so like everybody understood it. It's just the idea of the ticket was to bring, you know, it's put all the sponsors' names out there, everybody that helps with it. But these, you know, people that's involved in this are, like I said, they're behind the sport, 100% of, you know, ATV, motorcycle riding, side by sides, and to call these guys up and say, pitch the idea to it, and they all jumped on it. These people are the ones that we need to back year round. Not only because of this, because this is what keeps it better for next year.
Absolutely.
You know, and whoever wins the tickets involved, like I said, your name goes in the hat, you know, with Cometic Gasket. You know, okay, well, this person won the factory ride ticket, but he is technically the sponsored rider by you for the, you know, for your involvement with the ticket. You get, you know, the two up stuff, you mean, as the top ends and stuff from, say, Wozner. Ralph there, I mean, he has never, ever, he's 100% positive. It's about the sport, new product, you know, what do you need? You know, what do we need to do anything? You know, these people are behind it. And that is what's so awesome about it is the number of people are growing. So it's like when it seems like I've been around the race industry, it's been a roller coaster for, I mean, 20 plus years for me. just because, I mean, you have your good, bad years of sponsors, you know, not so many sponsors or just not that much help out there, but it seems like it's starting to come back around. Now with all the, I'm trying to think of the name of it.
I have the same moment. I do the same thing.
It's where I got it on the tip of my tongue, but just saying the right one, where you join organizations to get sponsors. We'll say it that way.
Oh, yeah. You know like Hook It or something like that.
Yeah, like the Hook It, stuff like that. Because these guys, these companies all are approached by Hook It. Okay, well, we'll operate that. We'll control this for you. We'll filter all your applicants and all that stuff. And one thing nice about these guys, I mean, that's not a bad service. But what I like is when I can call someone, and I mean, don't get me wrong, these guys, I'm not saying they don't have time to talk to each individual person all day long, but they make an attempt at it. These guys are, you know, heart and soul in the business. And these guys, when they, guys and girls, when it's about racing or something, it might take a day to get to them, but they respond and they talk about it. And this is the true blood behind the race events, because they're the ones that have to, you know, they have to deal with me. So
right.
They're behind it because they're like, listen, I'm going to beat on them, you know, till I get that answer. But everyone's been really good with it. And that's where getting back to all the people involved in our series that come around. We like the family atmosphere. We like the idea that we have groups from all over the place. It's like Brownsville. There's a park down there. After the race this year, the park board called, hey, we're doing a thing. You know, they're trying to raise more money for the park. They was wanting information of how many people, you know, obviously they know how many people is there, but how many people are there from out of state, from outside, you know, the state of Pennsylvania? And I'm like, well, 3/4 of them, you know, it's like,
right.
For real? And I'm like, well, yeah. I mean, there's literally Virginia, Vermont, a couple, there was several from New York. And they're going, really? There's people coming that far? Like, yes, there's people coming from that far away.
Yeah.
And this census thing that they done, because that's where, like, I would just say it's going through, like, Parks and Recreation Board. Obviously, they're trying to get grants because there's people coming around. But just imagine if we could get the rest of the world to be interested in one thing without causing havoc all the time. And that's where the organization, you can't go. Yes, the racing's competitive, everybody with the youth, the micro. But you can't go to a high school or junior high football game or soccer game and have this many people that's close-knit together. I'll lay money on it.
No, I guarantee. You go to, like you just said, you go to any football game, soccer game, baseball game, wrestling tournament, you name it. It is, you're not going to have that many close-knit people. I mean, you'll have your groups here and there, but for most, it's just going to be everybody just coming together for something, whereas like racing, man, I'm glad we found it. I wish it wouldn't have taken so long to find it, but it is really like a group of family there. And, you know, everyone gets on the track and it's a little bit of bumping and banging and you do what you do. But then afterwards, it's like it you're just back to being friends anymore. Nobody holds any grudges. That's what really impressed me about it.
Yeah, the one thing that's really nice about it, not that, but just like you said, when you're done racing, and now we're trying to find different venues and stuff, and it's kind of a fine line of, like, just say, like, Greensboro over there. Okay, Miller family that owns that property. Lisa I've always dealt with her. It's been, you know, she's always been over backwards for us. You do whatever you want to do. Just let me know here. And she's taking care of some issues with, you know, other things with us. It's a fun place to go to because it's fairly easy parking. But the idea of getting my whole goal with that place was because there's actually a public swimming pool just over the hill.
Oh, really?
And, yes. And my thoughts was one day, because we actually talked about it, Lisa's out 150%. About the community over there. What do you think about it? You got some people that gripe about coming in and listening to motorcycles and four-wheelers, you know, for the weekend. But what they don't realize is that community, you know, those people coming in there, we always use the fire department. They do food for us and stuff. That money all goes back to the community.
Yeah.
And if my goal was to be able to have the swimming pool open on days, because there's a park. There's actually a park down there. I think they have like a kid's pool and a regular swimming pool there, but there's pavilions. The idea was, and it's slowly getting here, because some of the kids, they'll come and race and they go to the swimming pool if it's hot, you know, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But trying to make the whole, I mean, we can't have everybody riding up and down the streets, of course, but it's in walking distance to get there, or if you drive down. But the idea of it was to go down and use the amenities of the town. There's a little restaurant there. There's the, you know, the swimming pool. Come in, camp for the weekend, just sit back and have a good time without, you know, disturbing the peace.
Yeah.
And it's starting to get there. And it's like, that's where we want all of our tracks laid back, where you come in, you can bench race from Friday until Sunday at 6 o'clock. Sunday at 6 o'clock, you got to go home.
Yeah, that's right.
But the idea, we're not, it's, we want everybody, you know, even come and hang out. It's the idea to see it and meet people, talk to people. You know, I don't think we've had that many bad apples, per se. You know what I mean? As far as getting along stuff. I mean, you have a couple people who get, you know, discouraged about some things, but nothing that they never got over, put it that way.
Yeah, no, you're always going to have that. But like I said, we're racing exclusively going to do the New East Coast next year, just because of how we've been treated there and the experiences we've had there. And also it's a lot closer for us too. And the tracks are nice. And,
right.
You know, we really enjoy the tracks, like the first one, which is coming up on the 18th of March, C&J Raceway. I love that track, and it's nice and close for us. I mean, within, you know, an hour and a half, which is close.
Isn't C&J Raceway where you hit the deer?
Yeah, that was where I hit the deer.
Yeah.
he likes to bring that up on every podcast.
Right.
But, you know.
Yeah, is that the pictures we've seen of hitting the deer on the hill climb?
Yeah. So,
I've hit him before too. It ain't that big a deal.
Yeah, I remember you telling me that.
Well, I've actually him just hit me. Period. So.
Yeah. Well, I don't know who was at fault with mine, but I think it hit me. So we'll just go with that.
Right. Yeah. I got that.
But we're closing in on 40 minutes, Ronnie. I mean, there was a couple other questions and. You know,
I'm good. Like I'm good. Like I said, it's just I was just worried about, you know, to see, make sure I had any interest for you, what you needed and stuff. But you know, the information wise, I mean,
yeah, it all seems good. It's all good to me. I mean, it's all about just talking to people and putting it out there and just getting something out there, because you know there's not a lot of stuff out there, and that's why we wanted to start doing the podcast was. You know, like you said, with the factory ticket and getting people out there riding, like I want to see the interest in it grow. I want to see people getting into it, and I'd like to see more of the manufacturers start coming back and taking notice of it, not just, you know, especially the ATV side. I mean, the bike thing, the bikes, you know, they make every kind of bike there is, every style of bike, but you know, it's like, ever since the side-by-sides came around, like they've just forgotten about the ATVs and,
well,
you know,
that's part of the government too, though. So,
yeah. And there's still a lot of people out there that will ride these ATVs if they can make them available.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's like me. I have a couple side-by-sides that we haven't used in years. We have them for sale. It's like it's not that we just dislike them, we don't really have the time, but they're not comfortable to me no more. I'd rather be on a quad or a bike myself. Mm-hmm. And they're just the expense. I mean, you're talking $25,000-$30,000 for a side by side now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And to go and be competitive with the, and say, okay, well, I want to go race one.
Oh,
to go
yeah,
race forget. One, it's like, it's crazy. It's astronomical money. And you take that $30,000 machine and you bounce off a tree with it, you do $10,000 worth of damage. If you don't have the Pelosi checkbooks, you're not going far.
Yeah. Yeah. Any of those government checkbooks.
Right.
But that's the thing. Like I know guys I work with. I mean, they all got these side by sides and they put this an ungodly amount of money into them. And that's after they spent an ungodly amount of money on them. And to me, it's like, why didn't you just go buy an old Jeep? And cause that's right. What it, me, it's like when the old farmers had these old samurais, they'd run them around the farm until they died and they'd get another one. That's kind of what it's like for me. Like I've never really not down talking them, but like, I just was never like attracted to that side by side deal. Like I was always on the quad or dirt bikes, one of the two.
Yeah. See, when we first started the race series, when 2008, when the Razor come out, the Polaris Razor, then we, like 2 or 3 years of racing them. Just, we'd only do like 3 or 4 a year. But the side-by-sides, I mean, they just do, they are so much property destruction.
Yeah.
You know, keep them in a closed course because obviously if the line starts getting bad, they're just running over whatever they can to get around. Well, you start running over your line went from, you know, 10 foot wide to now 100 foot wide. And
right.
We're on smaller, you know, pieces of land anyhow, because it's just really hard to find, you know, 1,000-acre plots to do these events at. It's, then we had to start looking at wear and tear on the tracks and then having the equipment to reclaim the tracks when we get that. And still it's like, man, it takes a lot longer to put this stuff back. And it just, then you start weighing the risk, you know, and it's like, to me, just, it wasn't worth it. I'm like, my wife, like she does scoring all the time. Like she said, she had more fun with the side-by-sides. At least it was more entertaining than having a couple of the e-bikes. The e-bike, you know, we tried it because that, you know, was going to be the new fad, whatever, which, hey, yes, it can be, but right now for our section of the sport, for our locals, yeah, we have, you know, 5 or 6 people with 100% dedicated, but we need that other 50 people to be dedicated, and to go out and buy a $6,000 to $10,000 bicycle is not in my budget. You know what I mean? So I can't see it myself.
Yeah. And that's like getting back to like the side-by-side thing too. Like, and now there are some people, and you know, I will say that we have a good bit of money in our 125, and there will always be the guys that have a pile of money in their ATVs. But I mean, the pile of money in an ATV compared to like a pile of money in a side-by-side is just, you'd price everybody out of it. It would get to the point where, I mean, if you didn't have $100,000 to put one of these things on the track, then you're just not going to have fun because you're going to get your teeth kicked in the whole time.
Right. Yeah. And it really takes to be 100% competitive. And one of those things, it takes a special person. I mean, the driving skill, but the mindset and stuff. And I mean, I know quite a few of those guys that done very well when I'm the Pratt boys and that. I mean, they definitely had a special skill set, you know? And it's just like, after being upside down in one a couple of times, you know, in some trees, it's like, I'm not a roll cage or a harness type of person.
Yeah.
Because that set and stop with a harness on hurts. I'm almost better off, you know, not glancing off a tree or just falling off the side of it. It's like you couldn't get away from it. I was in a Polaris Ace and hit a ditch. Oh my, that thing, that hurt me bad.
Yeah,
you know, on a quad you just skim it. You know what I mean? Stand up, but when you're strapped in, you know, in a seated position, that's not for me. So that wasn't my kind of riding at all.
Yeah, I got a bad back, so I couldn't be taking them jumps like that. So that would absolutely kill me. Like on a quad, I can use my legs, and one of those.
Right, right. Stand up. Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, so it's getting on 45 minutes, Ronnie. I don't want to keep you too much longer. And I know you said, you know, you're good, but I think we should probably just, you know, we'll call it here. It doesn't mean we can't have you on again. I definitely like to have you on again when we get closer to
race season
and even get you back on to talk about the 9-hour event, because that's right around my birthday. So I'll probably go to that. I probably won't race because I've seen the carnage of the bikes afterwards. And
it's a new location.
It is. It's where was it? I don't have that one wrote down where it is.
It's at that'll be what we call state line. The GNCC state. Called it high voltage.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, it's in Dunkard, PA. We're not doing that at Tanner's this year, but we're going to move it down, you know, down to there. Yeah, because the idea of it is, because this year we will be using the lights.
Oh, okay.
And we'll go into the dark.
That's good. And I'm really like what you're trying to do with it and bring something like what they have out west or out in the mid states with what do they call that one out there,
the Heartland Challenge,
and bring it out here to the east where there's a lot of guys.
But we used to do these years ago back in 03 I think it was 03 04, sorry, was it was called the Max, it was the Max, it's like the 12 Hours of America.
Mm-hmm.
And we've done a few of those, like in Rouse, out by Rouse Creek, Harrisburg, PA. They had like qualifiers in South Carolina, different places. We done those years ago, and it was a lot of fun because it was, you know, a few hours in the dark too. And that's where we was going after. That's where we brought this, was trying to bring us back from that. The Heartland Challenge, when it went to Iowa, we raced a 12-hour race in Iowa in 2004. It was the last one that we done with the factory Polaris. And
okay.
So, but we've been after this since 2004, really, to have, you know, an established one on the East Coast. And I've always talked about it. Then finally, when some other guys, you know, last year started talking about it, then Drew from Kenda, you know, he got involved and was like, hey, well, why don't we do this? It's like, oh, let's do this, you know? It's like, so we done it. Here it is.
Yeah. I really think it's take off too.
Yeah, it was a really good time. I mean, obviously there's some things that need to be adjusted, and just because we will be going, like I said, we will be going into the dark this year running headlights. And just like I said, just for the adults. But the idea of this, we want this to grow. But this is another thing we want to start on now. That's why once we got verification from Kenda, you know, a few weeks ago that, yes, we are doing it again. But we want to start having this now, the big push. So throughout the year, not only through our series, the New East Coast, but GNCC, I mean, people go to Mountain State or A-Works, whatever. This is where you get your friend that might you only see once a year there to ride. Like, hey, August 5th, they're doing that, you know, 9-hour race. Are you interested? This is where you pull friends in from other places. That might be the only time you see these people is once a year, but it's a different experience, and you have to experience it is the easiest way to say it.
Yeah, But
to get out and see how it works and how it's done, just like when we do our Triple Crown races Our Triple Crown races are literally just smaller versions, you know, of the 9 hour.
Yeah. Yeah. We raced our first Triple Crown last year as the father and son team. And I was the anchor on that team there. He Wait. Definitely pitched his weight plus mine.
Right.
Yeah. I have a stalling issue on my bike that he seems to find it very hilarious, but it wasn't so hilarious then when it cost us a couple places, was it?
Yeah.
It
wasn't very fun.
But, yeah, Ronnie, thanks for your time. I really like to do this again. You know, if you're up for it, you know, we can do it again. I'm sure there'll be at least, you know, four or five people that'll hear this.
Yeah.
So we're trying to beat our record last time. I think it was like 10 or 12 downloads, but I think there was more people that heard it. So that's just kind of what we're trying to do for the whole thing and try and grow it and get more people in it and just get more awareness out there.
Well, and another thing we can do too, and I do it to help out just as you get it going. Maybe we can do some giveaway stuff. I can get, you know, maybe some gate passes, do a small contest or whatever, where you're advertising it. We can do some gate pass giveaways. I can probably get Kenda to maybe give a couple, you know, tires up or something. Well, just to make it more fun to get people to pay attention to it more, you know? So,
yeah, no, I'm up for that. And like, I want to get it to the point where, you know, someday we can help other people out too, like by bringing them on. Like, you know, right now I'm kind of, we're relying on other people to kind of get this out there for us. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, hopefully one day, you know, we might be able to bring somebody else on and help them out a little bit. Cause, you know, that's my biggest thing now is just, I want to help as many people as I can. And being in this with him at the age now and knowing that he's got some time ahead of him, I'd like for it to, you know, be worth his while and have a great time. And I'd like to see more and more people get involved in it. And, you know, maybe this is the first step to getting more people involved in it is just the awareness.
Right.
So,
yeah, because there's definitely the new age of, you know, the new age of contact. If you're not online, you're not on nothing. So,
yeah. Like, if you're not online, you don't exist, which
right.
I don't necessarily think is a bad thing nowadays, but,
right.
you know, we kind of exist a little bit to keep the things going that we like to do. But other than that, I'd rather be completely anonymous in this world.
I got you. But basically, to control your destiny, I mean, it's like you got to step outside the realm every now and then to get there. But you still got to keep a toe on dry land to make sure of what's going on, you know,
right.
in the world. So. Well, that's my philosophy is do everything that you have to do, but only do what you want to when you need to.
Yeah, that's a good philosophy. I like that.
Right.
But, yeah, we'll let you go, Ronnie. Let you go spend some time with that new grandson of yours, and we'll definitely be in touch, hopefully before the first race. But if not, then we will see you at the first race, and we'll get you on here again. So I really appreciate taking the time out to talk with us.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, man. Well, I will talk to you later, and take care, buddy.
All right, thanks, guys.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, that was Ronnie Paul Wilson from the New East Coast. Super thankful to have him on here as our first guest. I hope it turned out fine. I was listening to it, and it sounded good. But, yeah, what a cool dude. Definitely a stand-up guy too. Met him at, you know, all the New East Coast races, and what a great series he runs. You know, that's what we're running exclusively, that and GNCC this year. So, really looking forward to that. First race is March 18th down in, Greensboro. No, I'm sorry. Newburgh, West Virginia.
C&J
Raceway, the side of the buckwheat. So we'll definitely be looking forward to that. And then other than that, we're just getting along, putting the bike together as the pieces come in here and there, doing a little bit of tweaks. I will say, and you've been asking me to do this for a while, is adjust your hand guards because your hand guards were so high. Those things are the bane of my existence. I hate those things.
I know you do.
They never line up. You can't ever seem to tweak them or turn them. And whenever you get them to where you want them, then something else is in the way. You get your brakes in the way. You get the clutch lever in the way, or the clutch lever, the brake levers are too long. So I finally had to do another modification that I've been fighting for so long, not wanting to do it, but I actually welded another tab onto it to give us a little more clearance because I couldn't bend it enough. I couldn't tweak it enough. So I bit the bullet and fired the old welder up and got that taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully that'll work for you. Anything else you want to talk about? Anything else you want to touch on?
No, not really.
Wow, you are full of just great tidbits and information and information to put on here. Yeah. So are you excited about this year?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What, I know we talked about it before, so let's review. What are your goals for this year? Let's start out with the new East Coast. What's your goal going into the new East Coast this season?
To get a podium and possibly a first place.
So you want to be your local series. You want to be on the podium and a first place.
Yeah.
Okay. How about GNCC?
I'll take a 12th.
A 12th.
Because every time we get 13th.
Yeah, well.
But I would like a podium. That would be nice.
That would be nice. And then my goals this year is to, I'm going to run the New East Coast. I don't know what group I'll run, what class I'll run, but my goal is to, after 10 minutes of being in the race, not want to kill myself and die and suffer through the rest of it. So that's my goal. I could care less where I finish, although I'd like to finish up there to kind of make it worthwhile. But my goal is to actually feel good when I finish the race. Feel as good mentally and physically when I finish the race as when I started the race. So other than that, anything else you would like to add?
No, not really.
Wow. My co-host is just really overshadowing me here. I can't even get in to talk about what I want to talk about because he's just so insightful with everything. Nothing else you want to talk about?
No.
Wow. I think we need to cut your pay because you're really not contributing enough.
I don't even get paid.
Well, yes, you do. You get to live here.
Oh.
So I guess with that, we will cut it, and hopefully next podcast, if this all works out and it sounds good and I'm able to make it work, we will have some more guests. So I got some more people lined up. It's just a matter of coordinating and getting it in there. So, getting with the schedule of things, you know, we were trying to do one a week. That's not going to work out. Maybe with the race season coming in, you know, we'll be able to do race recaps and stuff like that. So we'll have more stuff to talk about. But right now it's just the dead work of the off season and getting bikes together. And, you know, we don't want to make this about the podcast of how we made our bike and what we did with our bikes. But, you know, for right now, that's kind of all it is. So that, we are going to sign off. I am John Yankovich. This is
Colton Yankovich,
number 34, but number one in your hearts. Signing off. Remember,
no, wait, before we sign off, I think we can get 12 listeners.
12 listeners?
I think so.
Okay, we're going to shoot for 12 listeners this time.
Because we had a guest on.
Yeah, we had a guest on. So like and share, you know, tell everybody else about it and tell us, you know, say, hey, there's this podcaster. Kind of ridiculous and they're very low budget, but
yeah,
it's something to listen to. And with that, remember, keep it on all four wheels,
or three if you're on a three-wheeler.
That's right, we love the three-wheelers too. So I'm John.
This is Colton Yankovich
signing off. Talk to you later. The
the thief in the night.